the broadcast.
Yeah, it's shaping up to be a great match. A beautiful day here in Irvine as the opening faceoff is underway. McGill for the Aggies had it for a moment, but it's going to be St. Thomas who starts out with possession. The Tommies, perennial contenders in the MCLA. They're always in this conversation.
Right, they're wearing, you might notice, some people might notice that they're wearing gray today instead of black. They were here last year wearing black and decided that gray might be a little better for the temperature.
So a quick turnover sends Utah State the other way. Cole Benson brought it in for the Aggies. The Aggies coming out of the RMLC, not really on anyone's radar coming into the field, and nobody really knew exactly where to peg them, so they end up at a 15 seed. As you see down low, Blade Garlow quickly getting the ball, and he's a guy who's going to be the go-to for this offense. Garlow having a 70-point season. I mean, this is some special stuff that he's doing. A quick shot, low to low, and Utah State is on the board, 1-0.
And we'll have to start off with a yowza on that one just to get the program started. That was a sweet goal. He's has a lot of time, and he's feeling good today, feeling good. I talked to the coach, and this play coming up right now, he feels like he needs to control things at the midfield, especially with the faceoff, and he's feeling pretty good about that.
And for St. Thomas, it was Timothy Crocious on defense. He's been matched up with Garlow, and that's really a tough matchup for anyone in the country. He's a big body guy, but he's quick-footed as another St. Thomas faceoff win. So the 15 seed with an early 1-0 lead, but St. Thomas, as we mentioned earlier, so experienced.
It's another loose ball created and saved.
Yeah, I mean, this is exactly the type of play Utah State wants to be seeing. Is the ball coming free, loose balls that turn into 50-50 possessions. That's how they're going to win the turnover battle in this one. And now we're going to get our chance to see St. Thomas setting up their offense. They've looked a little hurried through the early goings.
Yeah, well, it's exciting, the first game, and they're looking to win this thing this year and return to the championship, which they've had for 4 years with a year or two in between.
It's hard to believe that a team can be that much of a dynasty, but it's been a great program as a pass up top ends up outside the restraining box. However, it stays with the Tommies. And St. Thomas had a period this season where people were starting to question a little bit. When
responsibility.
It's on us, all of us, to stop sexual assault.
Learn how and take the pledge at itsonus.org.
Thank you. on us to stand up.
To step in.
To take responsibility.
It's on us, all of us, to stop sexual assault.
Learn how and take the pledge at itsonus.org.
Big turnover.
Yep.
Great ground ball. Missouri Valley has to get this ball here. They have. I would call timeout. Oh, wow.
Hold called against Siena. Opportunity for the Vikings.
Wow.
Brown.
Oh, what a
save. Mayu save.
Unbelievable save there. Unreal.
If you're Siena Heights, you got to say, do you believe in miracles? Yes.
My goodness, Mayu with an incredible save one-on-one. Drops to the splits and makes the save. I believe it was a loose ball hold. Gives the ball back to Missouri Valley here late in the game. Quite an end to this game.
Yes, indeed. Here comes
what
Bosley.
A great defensive play.
Loose ball scramble. Who wants it? Frosch comes away with it. We have a hold.
Oh, no.
Hold against Missouri Valley, and it goes to Siena. And now a penalty.
Missouri Valley's just lost all composure. Coaches, players.
I don't know, was that an unsportsmanlike conduct penalty call? Now another penalty call against Missouri Valley. Boy, the Vikings are just coming unraveled. And head coach.
Wow. Wheels have fallen off the bus for Missouri Valley.
Yep. That's their assistant coach, Tyler Rankel. Obviously something he did not like.
Missouri Valley is about to pick up the ground ball and have another opportunity, but behind the play, they got Maudsley getting a little caught up with his defenseman. They call hold on him. He doesn't like it, says something, gets a flag. And then on top of that, one of the coaches over here from Missouri Valley can't contain
assistant.
His emotions.
Oh, man, he just blocked it.
And this will be a couple penalties. This game's all but over. And a win for Siena Heights. I would expect Missouri Valley to be down two or three men here, make it really difficult to get the ball back. Yeah.
Let's hear it from the officials. Three fouls on the Vikings.
Conduct on Maudsley there. On the coach, one call.
Right on that unsportsmanlike conduct penalty. Wow.
I mean, it is just amazing.
And here. Now a timeout call by Siena Heights.
Yeah, Siena Heights will just get organized here, space the field, make it really difficult for Missouri Valley to get the ball. I mean, we talked about having composure and everything like that. In the first two quarters, Siena Heights showed about zero composure as far as penalties. Not taking great shots, and that totally shifted over to Missouri Valley. Ran into a little adversity, not scoring goals in the second half. And not only that, but just mentally breaking down late in the game here between their players and coaching staff, making poor decisions, getting penalties late in the game that really slammed the door shut for any opportunity to come back and get a goal here late.
Just a crazy turn of events that have taken place in this game. Let's kind of break things down. The Vikings opened up with a pair of goals by Frosch and Doherty to take a 2-0 lead. A pair of goals by Lewandowski tied it at 2. Then four straight goals by Missouri Valley. Brown, Brzezinski, Brown, Brzezinski. It was 6-2 at the half. Then in the third quarter, Woods and Masick made it a 6-4 game. A goal by Maudsley made it 7-4. Then Kreitzer and Masick, 7-6. Here in the fourth, Polawati scored to tie it at 7, or with the current leading goal, making it 8-7. And that is the difference in this game. It is a one-goal game, 8-7. We're coming down to the waning moments of this one, and the Saints trying to pull off the miracle victory, the 14 seed against the number 3 seed.
So Siena Heights only has four defenders out there trying with their goalie to try and get the ball back here. But with not having to keep the ball in the box, Siena Heights is going to kill this clock here.
And that's what they are doing right now. Oh, my.
Wow, what a win.
They've only had one lead all game, and it was the goal by Orr here in the fourth.
Wow.
And that's 8-7. I mean, how many games have you seen where a team trails the entire game and they find a way to pull one out here on the neutral field of UC Irvine? The 14th seed, the Siena Heights Saints, have punched their ticket into tomorrow's quarterfinals.
Yeah, I mean, a good win by Siena Heights. You really hate to see any game end this way. I mean, a lot of emotions running high, players, coaches. But at the end of the day, in my opinion, Missouri Valley really handing this game over to Siena Heights. Just a real lack of composure on the field, mentally. You just hate to see any game, any contest end like this.
Well, the final score is 8-7 with the victory. Siena Heights now 13-2 with the loss. Missouri Valley finishes up their season with a record of 11-2. To me, Ryan Mayhew, the goalie for the Saints, has got to be the player of the game, because when the Saints' offense was struggling, he was making saves, kept them in the game, and then eventually they got their offense rolling.
Yeah, you said it. He kept them in the game for as long as he could, and however many saves he had, there were at least three or four of them that should count for two. Just standing on his head one-on-one, big time saves for him. Mayhew's my player of the game in a game that's a one-goal game under 10. A lot of times goalies are the ones that make the difference there. And man, Mayhew was phenomenal in cage.
Ed Maloney, the man who coached high school football for 43 years, coached three high school lacrosse programs in Michigan, four, all of which are now powers, and he's taken over the reins of the Siena Heights team. And a game in which the way it looked at halftime looked like they had no chance, but they get on fire in the second half, and they win by the count of 8-7.
Yeah, like we talked about, the theme of this game was runs and just keeping your composure. I mean, we saw Siena Heights, a lot of penalties in the first half, couldn't really get things going on the offensive end of the field. And then Missouri Valley, really, when things started to go were difficult for them, showed no composure at all, only, they only had, I want to say, one or two second-half goals. But on top of that, just penalty after penalty, coaches on the field screaming at the referee, getting penalties late in the game. I mean, Missouri Valley really handed this one over to Siena Heights.
Jeremy Siebert, it has been a pleasure. Wow, it has become an instant classic. Siena Heights 8 and Missouri Valley 7. That's going to wrap up the first of our four broadcasts today from UC Irvine. You're watching exclusive action of the MCLA 25 National Championships, powered by Under Armour, and this broadcast is being brought to you on MCLA.us in partnership with Lacrosse TV. For Jeremy Sieverts, I'm Mark Heller, saying so long from Irvine, California. Coming up next, it's Kennesaw State against Dayton. Until a few minutes from now,